Representative.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Good morning, Commissioner.
Good morning.
The governor spoke in his State of the State speech about community schools and community school environment. Can you give us some details, if you have any, about what his vision is for the community school environment that he's talking about putting in, and if there are any definitive plans on what it looks like, or if it's going to include nonprofit groups that are going to be in the school? What is any detail on that, please?
Yes. Well, the whole concept of a community school is that the school be a center point to provide opportunities to access supports for children and families that attend that school or are in that community. And it, depending on the needs of the community, it can look very different. I've visited schools in New York City that have not-for-profits that actually have offices and work all the day in the school with students and teachers and staff. And I've also visited schools in other places where the concept of a community school is that after school there's lots of opportunities for students to have access to programming that might not be included in the regular academic day, and those kinds of connections to social services and resources that are available in the community. So you might have a United Way program, you might have a Boys and Girls Club program or a YMCA program. So the question that you had about not-for-profits, that is a very common model that is used, where not-for-profits become part of providing services for the families and children at that school.
So I noticed that you didn't have it in your presentation. Is there a dollar amount that has been attached to it, or if there's a committee that's working to put it together, since you're saying it's going to be shaped in according to the needs of the district? Just to remind you, I represent Queens school districts 29, 28, and 27 primarily. One of our issues is that we have some of the longest commute times for any parent in New York City, coming from the edge of Queens in a transportation desert. Most parents have to leave for work at 7 o'clock in the morning. They don't get home until 7 o'clock at night. We don't have any type of community school program in any of those districts right now. Now I'd really like to see how that's going to be shaped, who's going to be part of shaping it, so that there's a universal model that can be. I know that it needs to be interchangeable parts for different districts and different areas, but there needs to be at least one consistent model that we can work from, so that it's not a hodgepodge of different things that don't work. I benefited from attending a school that was open until 7 o'clock at night. It made a big difference in my growing up, and I think that we need to have that model for all schools, frankly, across the state, where we can have children staying in school and off the streets. So I hope that we can start to work to that model to make sure that that's a statewide model as well. Is there a plan or a process that's going to help set up that community school program, and who's going to be involved in it?
Well, the proposal that is part of the executive budget provides $100 million in new community school aids, with $75 million available for struggling and persistently struggling schools that are in receivership. $25 million would be available for other high-needs districts identified under the Needs Resource Capacity Index. So that's kind of the overarching discussion that's already been made, and it's part of that executive budget. I would agree with you that it's important for us to provide a model. Now, as you pointed out, some schools and districts find specific things that they need for their families. Providing the opportunity for open schools early in the morning for parents that can accommodate parents that go to work early, and after school, I think is a very important model. And particularly in middle school, I mean, that is a time when having consistent kind of activities after school keeps kids doing the right things. And so We don't have any more information on that, and we are very supportive of community schools. I am concerned that if a school that was in receivership, so it fits the criteria that's discussed there, has already done the community school and started it, would they have access to the funding under the proposal? And I think those are all things that need to be worked out.
Well, I hope we can be part of those discussions, and that those discussions are, that we have an opportunity to weigh in on those things, to make sure that we have the right providers and the right model so that it's done. Even in schools where they're trying to do it already, I think there's some confusion about what the proper way is to shape it and where those continued resources are going to come from. Second question, the governor had a program to upgrade technology and infrastructure and Wi-Fi
yes.
access in the schools. Can you give us an update on where that is and how it's moving
yes.
forward?
So that's the Smart Schools Bond, and we have approximately, the districts are providing the proposals. We are helping them through our RIC centers that are dispersed around the state to come up with a positive approach to how they expend those funds. The breakdown of proposed expenditures, there are six categories that are allowed under the Smart Schools Bond Act. Those include classroom connectivity, community connectivity, classroom technology, the pre-K classrooms, high-tech security, and the replacement of transportable classroom units. So those are the things that are allowed under the Smart Schools Bond Act. Proposals for this have been submitted and are put through our facilities review group, and we're processing those to get them out.
So those are being processed by your information and technology staff, or is it something
no.
that each school district has to apply for, each community or municipality have to apply for? How does that get broken down?
So it was approved in 2014 so that they could acquire the technology equipment, install the broadband, and construct and enhance their education facilities, and install high-tech security. Those are the things that are allowed under it. They have to send proposals to us for the expenditures, and then they are able to expend that funds after that approval.
Okay. I'm just concerned about how it's breaking down to the local level, because I still have many principals that are speaking to me about the need for technology upgrades and actually wiring upgrades, because they can't even get the building up to spec because the buildings are so old. So I'm curious, and if you could send me some details on how that's being broken down so we can inform our principals of what they need to do to get into consideration for that available money.
Senator, we'll send that to you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And my last question is just on a kind of a follow-up to that. You talked about your needs, your lack of ability to provide technical support, and that you're understaffed in the ability to do technical support and information. Are you working with the various municipalities to empower them to pick up where you're not able to do, as far as making sure that the technical support and information is getting out to all of the school districts?
Well, relative to the smart bond, yes, our staffs, there are 17 centers that are technology-based centers that work with our BOCES programs, and they are working on what are smart expenditures of the smart bond money. And they've worked with individual school districts and have given them ideas on what should be the best investments for them that would be long term. And so that is occurring on a regular basis. And I was with them this week on Monday. They had a meeting here in Albany, and we had a long conversation about providing those resources and the expertise that they have in technology planning with the districts across the state.
All right. Thank you, Commissioner. I appreciate your answers. I hope that we can do more to ensure that those school districts that, and those principals that don't have good grant writers can at least get the information in a simple enough form that they can get caught up to, because if not, there'll always be a disparity that can't be bridged.